Yes. Start.
Perfect. So let me share the screen now. So let me know once you can see my screen.
Yeah, I'm able to see.
Okay, so as we discussed on the last session, like we will start with the spring fundamentals, right? So where we need to understand what is the spring and what all are the basic stuff as part of the spring. Okay, then once in the half sessions we'll try to cover the theoretical concept, then we'll cover the same thing with the practical stuff with the proper demo. Okay, so from the spring fundamental perspective, we have to understand first what exactly is the spring frameworks. Okay, so if you don't have a spring framework in the initial level, then what is the alternative options for you? So if you look at the spring framework definition, basically spring framework is an open source Java platform based framework, purely open source. There will be a no charge. Okay, it was initially written by the Rod Johnson and first initially released by the Apache, under the Apache 2.0, and which will be the license in the June 2003. And till now, the Spring framework is the most popular enterprise application development framework. Till now. And why? Because of the lightweight feature, because of the loose couple feature, because of the rapid application development feature. So basically, there are lots of features because of which Spring framework is the most popular and the development framework for the Java background. When we say the lightweight, so basically when the Spring framework launched in the initial phase, so it was actually 2 MB. The size of the Spring framework is the 2 MB. And if you go for the Struts or any other framework, so those framework are very heavyweight actually. So if you compare with the Struts and the Spring framework, then it's very lightweight, the Spring framework, from that perspective. Okay, and if you look at the dependency perspective, like to inject Spring framework in your application, Spring framework will not going to force you to use to this kind of class, this kind of APIs or something like this. But if you look at the Struts framework, like in the Struts framework, if you want to use the Struts framework, then you have to use any kind of APIs, extend class or something like this. You have to extend Struts class, then you are able to use the MVC features of that framework. So but the same thing will not applicable for the Spring framework. Spring framework is the independent and very loosely coupled things, where Spring framework will not going to force you to use any kind of things. So for that, we basically will have lots of feature for the Spring framework. So if you look at the higher level perspective, so Spring framework, if you look at the higher level period, so nowadays Spring framework is the most popular framework. And if you look at the Struts framework nowadays, we will nobody wants to use the Struts framework. So if any company has a legacy project which is built on the Struts framework, so that company is using. Otherwise, if any new project is building, so from that perspective, they will not use any kind of Struts framework. They only use the Spring framework. So it is the open source platform. Apart from, if you don't want to use the Spring framework, then you will have a Grails, you will have a Play, and you will have a any other framework as well. So mostly if you go for the Grails framework, so which is based on the Groovy and Groovy ecosystem based. If you look at the Play, so Play is also based on the Java. So but from those perspective, Spring is the most popular.
Okay,
so if you look at the why we need a Spring framework, so these are the benefits through which you can get the features, and you can say Spring framework is the most popular and is the open source platform. So as we mentioned, this is a very lightweight because it in the phase of initial version, it the size of the Spring framework is the 2 MB, because of we can say, and still if you look at the size of Spring framework, it's approximately 5 to 6 MB for the whole the whatever the minimum library we need to use it, right? But if you look at the if your requirement to add more libraries, then that will be something different things. But to inject the Spring framework, at least the size of that library will be the approximate 5 or 2 MB or 3 MB, something like this. Depends on which version of Spring framework you want to inject. Each version will have some features and some upgrades. So if this thing, if things will be the upgrade, then might be the size will be increased, right? So from that perspective, you can say this is the lightweight. Now, if we look at the second point, loose coupling. So spring framework has a feature of, you know, loose coupling because, you know, it supports a dependency injection. It supports, you know, the modular programmings. So you can develop each module separately and you can inject later. So from that perspective, you can say this is a very loose coupling, you know, Spring framework. And if you look at the third feature, like the cache validation transaction. So Spring framework by default support lots of stuff where if you want to achieve your, if you want to apply the, you know, caching system in your application, you can use the Spring framework annotation. Similar goes for the validation. If you want to apply the server side validation, it support the out of the box facility. And similar goes for the transaction. If your application is going to support the transactions, then you can put the transactional annotations through the Spring framework and you can achieve the features as well. Any doubt till now, or we can head with the next point?
No, you can continue.
Okay, so as we know that the things are the modularized in the Spring framework, then we can, it's very easy to test the things as well, right? If you look at the unit test perspective, if you look at the from the, you know, white box and black box testing perspective, things will be easy if you have a modularization, you know, in the programming or modularization things in your Spring framework. And everything is based on the POJO, so we can ignore this one. So the next one is the rapid application development. So the next, this is a very important feature of the Spring framework. So when you have a Spring Boot, you know, things, then you can develop your application rapidly where, you know, the lots of features by default available as part of your library or as part of your configuration or something like this, where the developer don't need to spend too much time to configure the applications. Only developer needs to focus on the business logic and to develop the things. So basically through which we can say the rapid application development support by the Spring framework as well. In the initial phase of Struts, if you look at the, you know, to connect with the database where you have to inject one layer of the JDBC or you will write some custom query, right, to query with the database, to fetch something, to save something, you have to write some queries manually, right? So, but if you look at the later, we thought like we have a ORM tool. So ORM supports lots of features with the Spring framework, where Spring framework has a lots of by default templates. By default, what does it mean by templates? So basically, Spring tells us Spring needs some configurations on that basis. Spring has some by default classes, JDBC templates class, Hibernate templates class, and we need to call their classes method only. We don't need to write whole query to fetch the record and to save the things. That's why the Spring supports the JDBC Hibernate template as well, out of the box facility, where only we need to call some methods and we can get the feature of database interaction as well.
Okay.
The next one is the JDBC exception handling. You know, earlier in the phase of Struts or in the phase of Servlet or JSP, as we know, you have to maintain each and every exceptions. Like if you want to inject the, you know, if you want to establish one connection of JDBC, where you mention class.forname, a get SQL connection, on all these kind of stuff you will write, and where you need to mention all these kind of stuff in the try catch, right? In the catch, you need to mention SQL exception. That means you have to maintain compile time exceptions as well. But if you look at the Spring framework, where you don't need to maintain these kind of things, most of the exception handlings are handled at the Spring framework level. From the developer perspective, we don't need to worry about it. We don't need to handle explicitly. So those exceptions will be handled internally by the Spring framework. The next one is the transaction management. So from the transaction management, you know, as we have already discussed, basically Spring framework support the transactions of, you know, annotations where you can, you know, roll back at the time of runtime exceptions. So these kind of things will be available by default as part of Spring framework. So for the transaction, we'll have a separate topics when we work with the Hibernate. So at that time, we will, you know, we'll have a separate one-day topic for the transaction management because this is one of the important feature of the Spring framework and also from the interview perspective as well. The next one is the Spring framework is the non invasive. So as I have already told you, it means that it does not force you, the developer, to implement or extend the Spring API in the application. It does not force you to use any kind of class to use the Spring framework, right? If you need any kind of feature, then you need to use it. But apart from that, to inject Spring framework, you don't need to use it, right? So these are the Spring framework feature. So in the from all of these, there are 4 to 5. The features are important. The first one is the lightweight. The second one is the transaction. Third one is the rapid application development. And the fourth and fifth one is the exception handling and CyberNet templates and invasive. So these are the important features of Spring framework. You have to remember when you go for the interview, what is the why you are using the Spring framework instead of any other framework. You can go for the Grails, you can go for the Play. So those framework have a different ecosystem, right? So here, these are the features of the Spring framework. If you have any doubt, we can discuss or we can go ahead with the next thing.
Just continue. Go ahead.
Perfect. Thank you. So as we have already know the what exactly is the Spring. This is the Spring is nothing but just an open source, you know, enterprise application framework. And why we need the Spring framework, as we have discussed now. Now, as part of the Spring module, so these are the Spring modules which we will gonna cover, as we have already discussed these things. The next thing is the design pattern. So when you are working with the Spring framework, so what all are the design pattern by default provided by the Spring framework? So if somebody asks you what kind of design patterns supported by the Spring framework, so you have to remember dependency injection or IOC is the design pattern which is supported by the, you know, the Spring framework. So where, you know, you have to use all these kind of feature, where we look at what exactly is the dependency injection, that will have a separate feature. But from the design perspective, you have to know factory design pattern. So if you look at the bean factory, if you heard about the bean factory, then there is one, you know, that is deprecated now, but in earlier phase of Spring 1 or 2 actually, so we'll have so at that time we have you know, the factory design pattern. So you can say, what is meaning by factory design pattern? So factory design pattern basically is nothing but just to this is the factory where it is used to generate any object or any bean actually, okay? So to generate anything, you have to create something internally, right? So basically, in form of Spring framework, the factory design pattern is supported because of it contains a lots of bean, or and it contains it needs to generate some of the beans. From that perspective, we can say the factory design patterns. If you look at the proxy design pattern, so from the proxy design pattern, if you look at the Hibernate and if you look at the higher level perspective, where is some of the things you need to work on the proxy design pattern. If you work on the Spring AOP, then there will be a concept of proxy design pattern. And similar goes for the singleton design pattern. If you work on any kind of bean, so in the there are lots of bean scope actually. So in the bean scope, if you will, by default, the scope of the all the bean will be the singleton design pattern, right? So from that perspective, you can say that this is a singleton design pattern. And MVC, so as we know, Spring support the MVC, you know, design pattern as well, where the model, view, controller, there are three stuff here. So from the model perspective, which represent any kind of entity which will interact with any your database or something like this, or view will represent your presentation layer, where your data or some or any kind of things will be displayed at your browser or any kind of page. And controller, where your, you know, which is used to handle your request and response. Okay, so from which higher level perspective, we can say this is the MVC design pattern. So these are the design pattern which is supported by default by the Spring framework. You have to know if these kind of things. Any doubt till now, or we can go ahead?
No, you can continue.
Okay, thank you. Okay, now as we know, if you start with the Spring framework, so first of all, you have to know what exactly is the bean, because in every discussion, bean word would be there, right? So from that perspective, you have to understand what exactly is the bean. So if you look at the core Java perspective, in the core Java, what if you need to create an object, what you are going to do. So you are going to do like any class name like employee, and object name and is equal to new employee, right? So where you are calling the constructor, right? Something like this, you are going to create any object of any class. So similar, I am saying, if you need to create a bean for any class, then you have to create, you know, bean for that class. So what exactly is the bean is? Bean is nothing but just an Java object actually, okay? If you look at the core Java perspective, you have a Java object, then you have to maintain the all the, you have to destroy the stuff and all these kind of things. How the things will be destroyed? If you assign the null or if the unreference will be there, then the Java, the system, the garbage collector will automatically detect that object and will, you know, destroy that object. So this is the life cycle of core Java. But if you look at the, you know, Spring life cycle of the bean, then where, you know, bean will have a separate life cycle. Bean creation will be separate life cycle, where bean will be create, bean will be destroy, bean will be initialized, bean will be, you know, you have a full options to, you know, create, perform some operation before creating the bean and after creating the bean as well. So that means is bean is nothing but just an object which is maintained by the Spring framework. Got it? Which is maintained by the
Spring framework.
You said the bean object. So who is going to initialize the bean object? If you somebody asks you, suppose you have a one constructor class, okay?
Container.
Yes. So suppose you have a one, if you need to initialize any object, so you normally you can initialize any object with passing some argument in the constructor, right? Similar goes for the Spring container. So basically, we can initialize the Spring bean through the Spring container, right? So up now, question, you heard word is the Spring container. What exactly is the Spring container is? What exactly is the Spring container? So if you look at the higher level, so Spring container is the thing through which you are going to maintain, or through which you can maintain the life cycle of bean. Okay, so who is going to maintain the life cycle of the bean? Spring bean, the Spring container or Spring
container.
Yeah, Spring container or Spring IOC container, both are the same word. Remember this one, Spring IOC container and Spring container, both are the same term which is used to maintain the life cycle of bean, which has a feature of to initialize, to destroy it, and to, you know, perform many other operations as well. You got it? The meaning of bean is nothing but object which is maintained by the Spring framework things.
Spring container. Yeah.
Yes. Okay. Now let's try to understand how to create the bean. As we know, we know the definition of bean, right? Now in the core Java, you know how to create the object. Now from the Spring perspective, how to create the bean? You have to understand, right? So there are three ways to create a bean in the Spring framework. There are through the annotation based configuration by using service component annotation. You can create a bean, okay, so where you can provide the name as of the bean. So what is the drawback of this annotation based configuration? So where you don't have two options to, you know, suppose there is one, you know, employee service, you want to create a bean where you will have a, you know, on no normal methods, the where you don't have any kind of setter or constructor for the employee service. Now so if you have this kind of requirement, then ideally you can use the service based annotation where you don't want to initialize the, you know, the things in the constructor or in the setter or something like this. You can go for the service. But similar goes for if you want to, there is a requirement to use in the employee service, you will have a constructor where you need to initialize something. Okay, then how you are going to initialize at that time, at that time you need to create the bean. Then how you are going to create the bean, right? So there are multiple things will be there. So you will have other option, like you can go for the Java based configuration or you can go for the XML based configuration to initialize the bean in such a way. So right, so annotation based configuration, you can use the service based and component based. The next one is the XML based configuration. So if you want, basically some of the things we can achieve through the XML based configuration. Suppose if you want to inject some strategy design patterns, okay, in that case you have to use the XML based configuration. Basically in our current project, we are using the, you know, XML-based configuration as well, and the service and annotation and Java-based configuration as well. So as per the requirement, you have to use it sometimes to follow any kind of standard. Sometimes you have to also follow any kind of design pattern. In that case, you have to use XML-based configuration to inject all the services into the one map or something like this. Okay, for that we need to use it. So we'll cover later part how to create that one. So you can create through the bean tag. Basically, there is one bean tag will be there, through which you can use the XML-based configuration. Got it, right?
Yes.
The next one is the Java-based configuration. What does it mean by Java-based configuration? When we say Java-based configuration, it represents a core Java. When we say Java-based configuration, it represents a core Java. What is it by core Java? How to create an object in the core Java? Okay, suppose I need to create a bean of employee service. Okay, then what I need to do is in form of core Java. Let me show you. So what we will do is, you know, the employee service. Can you see my screen, right? I am showing Notepad.
Yes.
So in the core Java, you are doing this is the employee service. Right. So how I want to create the bean of this with the core Java concept. So this is the public. I want to return the instance of, you know, employee service, and you can mention EMP or employee service, anything. Okay. So this is the method. This will return new employee. Okay. Employee service. And this is the bean. I put the annotation bean. And this is the core Java object. So basically, what does it mean by the core Java object? So this is the, basically I am using the pure core Java, you know, step to create any objects. After that, I put the bean annotations, which represent this is the bean, which represent this is the spring bean. Now, if you will put the bean annotation, then the whole life cycle of this object will maintain by the spring container.
Okay.
So this is the Java based configuration. So when we say Java based, then mean you have to use the new, you know, keyword to create any object. Otherwise, where if you look at the annotation base, where we are not going to provide any kind of new stuff, new or, you know, the new word or something like this, where only we need to put the service annotation at the class level and the component as well.
Okay, here @bean is written on the method.
Exactly. @ bean annotation, the scope of the bean annotation will be the method level.
Okay. Oh, it is written on the top of the method.
Yeah, so this is the method and you have to use here.
So I'm not able to see that one. Can you please just scroll left side?
Suppose this is the class, then I'm just putting the name is the config class. Okay. And this is your method. So here you need to put something like this.
Not able to see.
Sorry, can you come again?
I'm not able to see that @bean annotation.
Not able to see. Okay. Let me zoom it if you can. Can you see now?
No.
Let me reset then. Let me know now you can see my screen.
Yes.
So basically this is the, assume that this is the class and this is the employee, you know, employee service method, and here I'm going to return any kind of new and this is the bean.
Yes.
Okay. So if you are facing any delay or something like this, do let me know so that you can understand things will be in a, you know, better way.
Okay.
Okay, you got it right. So these are the three ways through which you can create the bean in the Spring framework. Okay. Now let's try to understand what exactly is the Spring container and what kind of, there are two types of Spring container and how many. So these are the things which we are going to cover, after this Spring Container, we'll have a demo to start the whatever we have discussed till now. Okay.
Okay.
First of all, you have to understand what exactly. First of all, you have to understand the Spring IOC container and container will be the same word. Okay. So IOC means inversion of control. The some of the articles or some of the people are using IOC and some of the words people are using the Spring container. IOC is the features of Spring framework, inversion out of or inversion of control, right? And this is the Spring container. So you can use both of the words are same. So now Spring IOC container creates a configure and connects the object which are called beans, then manage their life cycle. Got the meaning? And the IOC container is responsible. IOC container is responsible to instantaneously configure and assemble the object, and the IOC container gets the information from the XML file and work accordingly. So the line, forget about this line. Apart from this line, you have any doubt or you got the concept which we have already discussed?
No, it's okay.
Okay. So now the next line is the basically, you know, as we discussed how to create the bean in the Spring framework, there are multiple ways. XML based and
annotation-based,
Java-based, right? So how Spring container will know I need to create the bean for this one, right? So basically for that, we are using bean annotation for the Java-based configuration to tell the Spring framework to use this object as a bean. For the annotation-based, we are using the service or, you know, or component annotations. Telling Spring framework to scan those folder and to figure it out service and a component annotation and to create the bean for that one. Now, what about the XML base? We have to tell the Spring framework to scan this XML file, and create the bean accordingly. So this line represents this IOC container gets the information from the XML file and work accordingly.
Yes.
You got it, right?
Yeah.
Perfect. I think the other stuff is repeated now. The main task of perform IOC containers are that it will create the instance and application class to configure the object, assemble and disassemble the object. Okay, fine. So the next is the IOC container type. So there are two types of IOC container. You have already understand what exactly is the Spring container. Now you need to understand what kind of application containers are exist in the Spring framework. So there are two type of Spring container or IOC container are exist in the, you know, Spring framework. Bean container, sorry, bean factory or application context. Application context and bean factory. Now, what exactly is the bean factory and application context? What is the difference between both of them? Basically, let me tell you, bean factory is deprecated now. Nowadays, we are using application context. Bean factory has a lots of drawback or lots of, you know, the problems because of which the Spring community has decided to, you know, deprecated that one. And they continue with the application context. Now, if you look at what exactly is the drawback and all these kind of things, if you look at the higher level diagram in the slides, then how the hierarchy will be happen in case of Spring framework. Okay, so there is one bean factory interface. There is a one bean factory interface in the Spring framework. After that, there is one bean factory interface, and that interface will be extended by the application context. Why? Because application context is also an interface. Interface to interface, we need to use extend, right?
Extends.
Now, XML bean factory is the class where you need to implement the bean factory. Okay, XML bean factory is the class where you need to implement the bean factory interface. And so this is the, you know, higher level diagrams. Now, if you look at the application context, so there are three implementation of this interface. As we know, application context is the interface. So for that, you will have a three implementation for this interface: file system XML application context, class path XML application context, or web XML application context. There are three, you know, different kind of application context you will have, and you can use these kind of things. And now, what exactly is the benefit difference between these kind of things? So if you look at the table, so XML bean factory and application context which supports the annotation. Basically, you know, the XML bean subtree does not support the annotation. What does it mean by annotation? So basically, you know, there are lots of annotations like the, you know, the bean annotation, right? And configuration annotation. So there are kind of these kind of annotation which is not supported by the XML bean factory, and also there are another annotation which will be used as part of configuration. So those are not supported in the XML bean factory, but it is supported in the application context. Annotation based support provided by the application context.
Okay.
Bean post processor. Okay, so first of all, you have to understand what exactly is the bean post processor. So, you know, my requirement is to, as we know, suppose there is one employee service. Try to understand this scenario.
Okay.
So, this is my scenario, is the employee service. I have one employee service. I put one annotation. I put one annotation service layer, okay? And system will going to scan this class and create the bean. But my requirement is to, you know, before creating the bean of employee service, I want to perform some action.
Okay.
How you are going to create? You don't have any options here. Because the life cycle of this, you know, this instance or for the bean will managed by the Spring container, right?
Okay.
So basically, bean post processor is the part of Spring life cycle. Sorry, the IOC container life cycle. IOC container life cycle is the part of IOC container life cycle where you have options to perform an operation before creating the bean and after creating the bean.
Okay.
And when these beans will be created, while your application, first of all, system will going to create the application context. After creating the application context, all the bean will be created by the application container and will hold in the application container. If somebody asks you where all the bean will be exist, your answer will be the Spring container. As the name suggests, Spring container. That means it contains all the beans, right? And also it manages the life cycle as well. So it's in future, if you need to, if you need the bean, then you can look up into the Spring container and you can get the bean, right? So what is meaning of Spring container is the application context. There is the one get bean method of application context, and we are calling get bean of application context, and will return the, you know, it will return the bean of any class.
Bean of, okay.
Yes. You got it, this one?
Yeah.
So my question, basically the problem statement says the bean post processor registration. So basically some of the registration you have to do. So for that XML bean factory, you don't have automatic process to do that one. So you will have a manual process actually. But for the application context, you will have an automatic process.
Okay.
So for the, you know, implementation perspective, there is one implementation. So here in the, you know, the hierarchy, you can see the implementation where the bean factory interface will have only, you know, XML bean factory class and class path file system and web XML implementation for the application context interface as well. For the XML bean factory, This is the class, right? No further implementation for this class.
Okay.
Right. So the next one is the internalization. So as we know, you have to work with the I18 properties. You know the I18 property?
Yeah,
perfect. So if suppose you want to feature the get the feature of internalization, or you want to get some message on the basis of, you know, the locale or something like this, in that case the things will be not supported by out of the box in the XML bean factory, so it's supported in the application context.
Okay.
So we'll go for the enterprise services. If you will integrate any kind of enterprise services, Spring integration and any other kind of, you know, third party services, enterprise services, so those services will be, the application context, not as a XML bean factory.
Okay.
The next one is the application event. So application event, when we use the word application event, what does it mean by application event? Application event means if your application is started, a priori, suppose my requirement is to, when your application is started successfully, then I want to perform some action, right? So for that, your startup, there is one events, ready event, stop event, right? So these are the application events in your Spring container or Spring, you know, things, Spring framework, something like this. So you can, you know, application refresh event, you know, start and stop event. So these kind of application event, you can inject in case of application context, but not for the XML bean factory. So these are the bean factory and application context, you know, differences, and you have to know from the annotation perspective, we bean post processor, implementation, for the implementation, you should know only the bean factory interface where these kind of hierarchy will be applicable, and for the internalization and application event. At least there are four options you need to remember: application event, internalization and implementation, and bean post processor. There are 4 to 5 things you need to remember as part of interview. Might be somebody ask you, what is the Spring container and how many types of Spring container are exist as part of Spring framework? And you can also mention bean factory is the deprecated now, we are not using. Immediate question will be like, why it is deprecated? You can answer something like this one.
Okay.
You got all these kind of things, or I mean,
yes.
You have any doubt?
Yes, I got it. I did. And one more thing. Are you going to provide this material, whatever now?
Yeah,
you can
use it. So
yeah, it will help out for me to have a revision.
Sure. I will, you know, once the today's session is over, you can take the, you know.
Yeah, immediately.
Yes, immediately. You can. This is the public access, so you can use it.
Oh. Okay, fine. Just share me this link.
Sure. So yeah. So any doubt, or we can go ahead?
No doubt.
Perfect. So now let's start with our demo, whatever we have discussed so far. So as we know, we are working with the Spring framework or Spring Bootstrap. So let me create one, you know, initializer project. So for that, to create a you know, Spring initializer, you can, you know, go to the Spring initializer and you can create one, you know, sample project, which is it will create a folder structure and it will put some dependency as well. So now let me know which build tool you want to go with, the Maven or with the Gradle?
Maven.
Perfect. So I have selected Maven, and so as part of Spring framework, this initializer will display, there are 3 languages: Java, Groovy and Kotlin. Why these 3 languages? Because, you know, these languages are based on JVM based. Basically, if somebody asks you what all are the JVM based languages, so your answer would be Java, Groovy and Kotlin, or these kind of language which support the Spring framework.
Okay.
So let me take com. So when you cut any kind of project, you have to provide project metadata, what would be the group name, artifact and name. So when you use the group name, something like this, your domain name, when suppose you are part of any organizations, you have to provide any kind of, you know, domain name or something like this. What about the architect? Artifact would be represent artifact which represent your application title, application or project title. This is the loyalty project, this is the, you know, Max Pop project or something like this, whatever you can take it. And this is something same, you know, the name would be the descriptions where you can provide some proper naming convention, but in the artifact you have to use all the things will be in the lowercase with the proper, you know, it has some restrictions over some characters and something like this, because the group and artifact will be used as part of your, you know, as part of your, you know, artifact, your packet, you know, once you have created the packet, right, the packet name would be something like this. What is meaning of packet here is, when you build your application, there will be a jar or war file, right? So that war and jar will be the artifact. Got it, right? Your jar and war will be your artifact. So what is the name of that artifact? So this is the name. So for that, you have to follow proper naming convention for that one. That means what is the naming convention? whenever whatever the file name you have provided is part of any operating system. Suppose you are creating any file on Windows, so Windows has some different naming convention to create a file. You can't put some special character, right, or something like this. So those things you have to take care while creating artifact. It should be a proper naming convention. Descriptions, you can provide your project descriptions, package name, whatever you have things. So this is the group name or this is the package name. Okay, so we can talk this company demo. We can this first demo. So you want to go with the jar or war packaging?
Jar.
Okay, so you want to go with the 8 or 11, 14? I think 8 will be the good for you, because 11 and 14 will be something different features and will be the paid for as well. But for the development, it's open.
Oh, okay.
So I'll go with the 8, and because lots of feature will be deprecated as part of 11 or 14. So in that case, it will create a problem. So, okay, no problem. So generate. No. So now you have created the on basic, you have provided the basic information. Now, what you want to do with this project? You want to inject any Spring framework, right? So yes. To inject Spring framework, let me add one dependency, web. If you can see the difference definition of Spring web, building this, what is the purpose of this library? Building web application, including RESTful application using the Spring MVC, use Apache Tomcat as the default embedded container. If you want to use this library for this purpose, whatever the mention in the drop down, so for that we will use this one. As our target is to create one, you know, endpoint, and we'll use the different kind of bin creation thing. So we will use the Spring web. That means to inject any Spring framework in your any application, you have to use this library.
Okay.
This is the default, you know, Tomcat server. If you don't want to use the Tomcat server, later we will exclude this server and we will use the Jetty. Got it, right? So I have included this library and I am generating this project now. So first demo, let me create a name with this folder with you so that we can put over there. So this is the first demo. Let me one second. So let me extract here. This is the first demo. Let me open this project in my IDEA. Where is the first demo? Where is the first demo?
Yeah, seventh.
Yes, this one. Okay, so let me open this project. So I have opened this one. So it will take some, you know, 1 minute or something like this to download all the dependencies, right? So when you open any project, then first of all, it will download automatically all the dependencies with, you know, you can see the things are downloaded, it's, right?
Now you are creating Spring Boot application.
Yes, we have created. We have created the Spring Boot applications with the all Spring feature.
Okay. No, just now you have used one tool. Is that a Spring Boot tool?
Yeah, so this is the...
This one.
Yeah, star.spring.io is the Spring community, you know, website or, you know, the product or something like this, where you can create your project as part of scaffolding. It is the empty project. Let me explain one by one thing. So where when you start any project, you so you can create from here.
Okay.
Okay. So this is the first demo. If you look at this project, so this is the folder structure which is provided by the Spring community. So first, when you start any project or when you look any project, first of all, you have to start with the pom.xml.
Yeah.
So you have to start like this is the parent ID or group ID, whatever we have discussed. If somebody asks you which Spring Boot version you are using, where you will check? You have to check your parent version. So this is your parent version. Spring Boot Starter parent version 2.3.0. So we are using the Spring Boot 2.3.0 version as part of this demo. So this is the group ID and artifact ID, and this is the version which is provided automatically by the system. This is the name, this is the descriptions. Whatever the meta information you have provided here, so this is the meta information. Got it? And this is the Java version, whatever you have selected here. And the next is the dependencies. Now what, as we know, this is the normal Java project. Now I want to inject Spring framework in this project. So as we are doing the Spring Boot, so we need to use only one library. The library name is called Spring Boot Starter Web to achieve the feature of Spring MVC and to achieve the feature of RESTful web services. All the dependency will be the part of single dependency. So what is the test library for those feature whatever we have discussed now, like the MVC, RESTful, so forth. For the test library will be used for the, you know, Spring Boot Starter test. What does it mean by test library? The test library is used for the integration test or for the unit test case. Got it? And if you look at the build version, so as we know, we are using the Spring Boot Maven plugin to build your any application. You have to use any kind of plugin to build your application. Either you can use the by default build whatever the plugin are there, or you can use third party external build tool as well. This is up to your requirement. Okay, so we will use the Spring Boot default Maven plugin. So if you look at the higher level perspective, that if any kind of POM will consist of, there are 2 to 3 parts. The first one is the, you know, let me explain. There are the upper part will represent a metadata informations. Okay, so this is the properties. If you want to use any kind of properties in the Java in the POM, then you can mention all the properties here. The important part of the dependencies, if you want to use any kind of third party dependencies or any kind of dependencies, you need to put here as part of, you know, any kind of as dependency, you have to put in the dependencies section. The next one is the build. So you can put all the plugins in your build, and there is one more, you know, that takes plugins external from this one as well. So you can plugins from here as well. Some of the plugins will be used as part of build, and some of the plugin will be used as part of something different for purpose. So you can use plugins here and and use as well, and you can provide the things as well. So this has something different purpose. Later we will use as per our requirement.
Okay.
So whole form will be divided into 3 to 4 category: the build, dependencies, properties, and the other metadata information. And as part of the Spring framework, you have to include only one library, which is a starter form web library. In the phase of initial, if you don't have a Spring Boot application, then you have to use at least 6 to 7 Spring library to use the feature of Spring MVC. Got it?
Okay.
Any doubt till now, or we can go ahead?
No, you can continue. Okay.
So no, as no. Right, as we know, this is the Maven project, or for that every Maven project you will have a one pom.xml file. If you will not have any pom.xml file, that project will not represent a Maven project. Okay, because all the things will be exist in the pom.xml settings, configurations, dependencies, so that when system is going to be up, and at that time things will be download at that time or something like this. So let me explain one more thing. So as part of dependencies, if somebody asks you what is the scope of dependencies, there are three types of, there are three scope of any dependencies: test, compile, or runtime. Test, compile, or runtime. There are three scope of any dependency. When this dependency will be executed, you can mention, you can restrict. This dependency should use at the runtime. For that, only you need to use the scope and you can mention runtime. So this property will use to set the scope of this dependency. You can mention this will be used as part of compile time, because if you are using any kind of things and classes of this library at the compile time, then you have to use the compile time. Some of the things we are not using as part of this one, and you can use the, you know, the runtime things as well. Like MySQL library will be used as part of runtime, which is not used as part of compile time. So that kind of stuff you have to use and you have to think. Like, so you can understand. So this is the test library. So you will use, this will execute as part of test scope, right? It will not execute as part of your actual functional behavior, right? So you can mention the scope, this as a test. Just to restrict the, you know, library, so where this library will be used as part of the compile and the runtime. So this is the important part. Might be asked the questions in the interview as well, if somebody wants to, you know about the form or something like this. In that case, you got it right.
Okay, yeah,
perfect. So this is the form where you, for the Maven. And now the next one is the if you look at, there are three to four files. This is a MVNW file where the things will be, you know, that this is the script actually. This is the shell script. This is the shell script when you are working with the, when you are working with the, you know, any kind of Mac or Unix, Linux system, then, you know, Linux system, then you will have a form. Then you don't need to fire this command like, you know, I want to MVN clean or package or you don't need to fire the command of all the Maven, like the you know, the MVN Spring Boot colon run. To run your Spring Boot application, you need to fire this command, right? This is the plan command. If you will work with the any kind of if you want to work with the scripting, things will be already existed as part of scripted. So what you need to do is only you need to fire MVNW. In the command, you need to fire this command and things will be automatically up as per your project configuration.
Okay.
This is similar to this command, and if you are using the any kind of Windows, then you need to use this CMD. Got it?
Yeah.
So
this command is good. The second one, mvnw.cmd.
So basically .cmd is used for Windows platform. So okay. If you are working on the Windows platform, then you only need to fire mvn.cmd. This command is used to trigger your project.
Okay.
So the next file is the help.md file. You know, if you want to, suppose this is your project. So let me explain one thing. You know MD file or I'll need to explain?
No, I don't know.
Okay, perfect. No worries. So let me explain something. So suppose when you are on the Git or you want to, okay, let me open this one. Okay, so So suppose this is the project. So this is the project where you are providing this metadata information. I mean that this project information might be the installation step or some, you know, the configuration or all these kind of things, right? So I have provided all the configurations and all the, you know, readme stuff, something like this. That means before starting any project, you should read these informations to get it done or to get it installed or something like this. So for that, these metadata information, you can provide it in the readme.md file. The extension should be the .md file. Either you can use help.md or you can use readme.md file, where you can provide all these kind of information and you can see that these are the, you know, just getting started or these are the basically to document, for the document purpose you can mention, you can use it.
Oh.
So the next file is the IML. Basically, the IML file, basically when you open any project with the IntelliJ IDEA IDE, then you will have a .IML file. Like similar, if you open any project with any Eclipse or something like this, then you will have some settings file or settings, Spring Beans or factory part, dot class part. These files will be generated as part of the IntelliJ IDEA or Eclipse. So ignore these things, IML or settings file, because these are the part of any IDE, right?
Okay.
Next is the .mvn folder. So basically, whatever, if you want to provide any, suppose you want to provide any kind of configuration or properties as throughout all the mvn, then you can provide, you have to provide all the configurations here, or you have to use here, so that system will going to detect all the properties from here and use it accordingly in the form and any other command as well.
Okay.
So this is the .mvn file, and you can ignore .idea file. And now there is one more file, .git ignore. Suppose this is the project, I don't want to commit or push any file which is not required as part of project in the Git repository. So I can mention all the extensions here, folder name here, whatever I want to exclude from here to there. Actually, I don't want to push any kind of these extension files in the Git repository, because these are the part of IDE or any kind of stuff or something like this. So you can put things will be the Git ignore, in the Git ignore. Okay, so now the one of the most important folder is the source folder. So in the source folder will contain, there are two things, main and test. You can ignore that for now, because test will contain the unit test stuff. Okay, you can ignore the test cases, this one, and we can start with the main folder. So in the main folder, there are two folder here, Java and resources. So all the resources will be exist as part of main. So when you say resources, so resources will be the part of static content. Anything which is used as part, anything which is used as part of static content in your any project, like it can be a properties file, it can be a .js file, CSS file, .template, or these are the some static content in your project. So these static content will be part of the resources, any third party resources, any file which you want to include, any kind of things which is used as part of resource, you have to put under the resource folder. So here you can see the application.properties file. This is the empty file which is used to, suppose you want to provide any kind of configuration in your project. So all the configurations will be part of application.properties file. You have to provide all the configuration properties here as part of key value pair, and the system will automatically detect all the and on the basis of key and will provide the configuration accordingly. The next one is the static and template. As I already mentioned, static is used for mainly use the JS, CSS, and for the web content or something like this. Template, if you are working on any kind of pre-marker template, any kind of ThemeLib, any kind of JSP, any kind of GSP, any kind of server-side template you are working, so in that case, you have to put all the extension file .html, .jsp, the .ftl, and all these files will be part of this template. All these files will be under the template folder. The next one is the Java folder. So this is your pure Java code. So where this is the folder structure or package name, which we have provided here as part of the Spring Initializer project. And this is your application. So this is your simple application. So where your application will be kick off or start the things. This is the main method. Every Spring Boot applications will have a main applications where main methods, and things will going to be up from here as well. Okay, so as I already mentioned in the initial level, the Spring Boot, this is the Spring Boot project. Then the Spring Boot project will have a default embedded Tomcat server. So the default embedded Tomcat server will be part of this library. Okay, If you look at this library, you will have this. If you look at this library, you can get these. These are the dependencies. Can you see my screen? External libraries. So you can ignore the test libraries. Apart from all the tests, you can see, you know, AOP, beans, contents. If you are not using any kind of, you know, the Spring Boot framework, and you want to only use the Spring framework in the phase of initial level, the people needs to be inject all these kind of libraries, right? MVC, web, JCL, expression, core, context, bean, AOP. These kind of library people needs to be injected. But as part of Spring Boot, only need to inject one library, and this feature is called starter form. And all the things will be, you know, fetch as per the latest version. So as you can see, somebody asked you which version of Spring you are using. We are using version Spring 5. You can see 5x version Spring, you know, will be picked. And Spring Boot version will be the 2.3.0. Spring Boot 2.3.0, and Spring is the 5 version. Spring 5 version we are using. So now let's discuss about the Tomcat. So this is the Tomcat. This is the Tomcat library, which is the part of this library, web library. Okay, so if you want to exclude this library, what you need to use it, only you need to provide one exclusion. Only one you need to provide exclusion, and you need to provide the library name here, like Tomcat or whatever the org. Or so you need to provide the, you know, what is the dependencies. Let me provide here. So this is the dependencies. You can provide dependency group ID will be the group ID will be the org Spring Boot. I mean to say, this is the you need to pass. Group ID will be the Spring Boot org and the artifact name Tomcat, or up to this one. You have to pass this one, and since things will be automatically, deprecated or will be removed. So let me show you this one. So can you see my screen?
Yeah.
I can show you slides. Yes. You can see this one.
Just zoom in. Yeah.
So this is the way through which I am excluding the Tomcat and adding the Jetty. So if you look at the last dependency where I am adding the Jetty server.
Okay.
So this is the way. So here you can see if you want to look at the dependency, what all are the dependencies will be covered as part of this Spring Boot starter web. Here you can see these are the dependencies covered as part of, you know, this is the Spring Boot starter web, and the other library will be part of some, you can say, the utils and all these kind of things. You can say the Tomcat embedded, Tomcat core, WebSocket, lots of things will be there. And whatever, if you want to override the configuration of Tomcat, like I don't want to satisfied with the default configuration of Tomcat, then how you will going to override? Like I want to up the server at the, you know, any port, like server dot port will be the 8080. I want to up my application 8080. So you can override this information with the properties file. I want to, you know, I want to change any kind of properties as well. Here you can see that these are the properties which you can override for the Tomcat server as well. These are the properties. There are lots of properties for the Tomcat server, right? For the username, password, validation, lots of properties are there. You can override each and everything. So you can use it as per your requirement. So we will use once we are, when we start this project. So any doubt till now, or we can go ahead?
No doubts.
Perfect. So this is the Spring Boot project, where this is the main method where you can kick off the stuff. And the next, here you will see this is the main method. Here you will see this is the Spring Boot application annotation. Okay. So this is, it has some, you know, meaning, or it has some, you know, lots of things will be dependent on this annotation. So we'll cover the separate, you know, the next tomorrow we'll use this, you know, we'll explain what is this and how, why we are calling this one, how to use it, and all these kind of things we'll cover. And after that we are going to, you know, explain the other stuff as well. So for now I'm skipping this Spring Boot application annotation, because for that we'll have a separate, you know, session as well. So now I am going to start the bean creation. As part of today's session, we have discussed, you know, the how many ways to create the bean. So let me explain that stuff, then we can go ahead with the next one.
Oh.
Okay, so for that I need to show something. So I let me create some classes, something like this, or you can ask me if you have any doubt. So let me doubt controller package. Let me create a service package. Let me create the domain. Let me create okay, it's fine for now. Or we can create a config as well. Config. So let's try to create a one class will be the employee controller. Let me create one class. We don't need the domain for now. I can play with that service as well. Okay, we can create now. So I need to create a one employee service. Okay, so I want to expose one endpoint REST controller and I want to return some stuff. The requirement is to request mapping. I want to provide /API/v1 and employee, and I want to use the one method. I want to return some what employee things. Employee, I need to provide some data as well. Private string, name, private string, email, something like this. I am providing those information. Need to setter and getter for this one. Setter and getter, and let generate. Get, and let me provide some meaningful information over there. Let me provide get mapping here, and this is the /get. Okay, so I am providing some get methods, and now I need to return. I need to inject one service. So this is the service. I need to put service annotation, and I need to create some employee object here. Get, and I need to return some return employee equal to new employee dot set email id test.gmail.com and employee dot set names dot test dot test is the name, return employee. So this is the name, and this is the class, this is the name, and this is the employee service which we need to auto add inject here as part of dependency injection. So for the dependency injection we'll have a separate session. Okay, so don't worry, we'll cover that one, because if you will go one by one things, then we'll try to understand this stuff in a better way. So get, and this is the return, and let's try to check it out, things will be working fine or not. So we have exposed one API with the local host 8080/api/v1/employee/get. Application is started now. When you get this application is started now, Tomcat is started now. So this is the application which you can see the hello.
Yeah,
can you hear me? Now I have created the one sample API, and now I can show you on the screen that the API is written the name and email. Okay,
yes,
okay. So now let's try to understand the many of ways to create a bean. So here if you look at the service annotation, so basically we have created one employee service class where if you have put the service annotations, and the things will be automatically inject and going to be return the response as well. So when Spring Boot application will be up at that time, it is going to be scan this folder. It is going to be scanned this folder. Okay, scan this folder and try to figure it out what all are the classes which is annotated with the service component or these annotations, so that system will going to create a bean for you. So for that, system will create any bean of employee service. Employee service bean will be created in the Spring container while up the application. After that, we are able to inject any if you have any bean in your container, then you can inject that bean as part of dependency injection in the employee controller. So we'll cover that part separately, but for now I'm just showing we have injected and we have calling that method of from here, and we are going to return this one. Okay, so basically this is the way through which you can create the bean using the annotation base. Okay, now if you remove this one, so I have removed the service annotation, okay, and I am auto wiring this annotation. So can you tell me will it work or not?
Yeah, it will work.
No, it will not work. It will return an error. So let me rerun and you can see it will say no, you don't have bean, something like this.
Okay, object you is can, not there for employee service.
You can say the unsatisfied bean, you don't have the bean with this name, whatever the bean with this name is not exist, right? That means what? You can't auto wired any bean, any things without having any bean. You can't auto wired anything without having bean. If you will have a bean in the Spring container, then you can auto wired or inject the things, otherwise you can't. Got it? You need to remember this one. Might be interviewer can ask you, if I don't have any kind of bean, and can I auto wired or not? Can I inject or not? Your answer should be no. You can't inject.
Okay.
So this is the employee service. Now I want to create a bean with the XML. Try to understand. I want to create a bean. So I have already explained with the annotation base, with the Java annotation and service annotation. Now I want to create a same bean with the what? XML bean. So let me create a XML file, Spring config. So we can provide the name with the what? Beans.xml. Spring beans. Okay, so I have created the Spring beans. This is the Spring beans XML file. Okay, so when you say Spring beans, so it contains the beans annotations. Okay, all the bean of any class will be existed part of beans tag. So now let's try the bean. As I already mentioned, to how you will create the bean with the any class. So for that you need to use the bean tag. So you need to provide the class name to the any bean. So where is your class? Which class you want to create the bean? So I want to create the bean of service of employee service. Got it?
Yeah.
So now you have created the bean. Now let me, you know, you have to provide some naming convention as well. So this is the naming convention. Okay, you have to provide some ID or name so that it is going to be injected. Okay, now you have created the bean. If I run this application now, will it work or not?
Yes, it will work.
No, it will not work. Why? Because where you mention system needs to pick spring-beans.xml file, where you mention the system needs to figure it out, this is the XML file I need to scan and I need to create the beans.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
You mention anywhere?
No.
No, right?
Yeah,
if I run this one, you will get some error. You got the error?
Yeah, unsatisfied dependent.
So now how you will inject? So you, for that, I am going to inject import resource. If you will use the import resource here, I am going to telling, please use the class path. So I am using class path. It is asking me to provide the file name. So I provided XML file name. Now system is going to be scan this file and will create a bean accordingly.
Bean.
Okay. Or now you can see the automatically error is removed here. This is the IntelliJ IDEA feature. Okay. Let me show you one more thing. So if I remove this annotation here, and again I am coming here. Here you can see could not auto wire, no beans of employee service. This is the feature of IntelliJ IDEA. You will not get this feature in the Eclipse or something like this. You will get the compile time error, right? So either so this is the feature of IntelliJ IDEA. Now if you will put this things here, then you are able to fetch, you are able to use these things. Here you can see the error is automatically removed, right?
Yeah.
And if you will run this now, you will not get any error now. here you can see the application is started successfully now, and if you will run and you will get the output. Got it?
Yeah.
So this is the way through which you can create the XML based bean. You got it, and we'll explain separately. We'll have a separate session of XML bean because it has a lots of things, right? Inheritance things, and or factory things, factory then initialization things, lots of things like the initialization. So we'll cover separate part. For now, you only need to understand how many ways to create the bean, and you need to know how to create the bean in the XML. Now you know, right? How to create the bean in the XML, right? So purpose of today's session is to create the number of beans and how to create the beans, or nothing else. Now I am commenting this bean now, and now you will get this error again. Okay. Now I want to create the bean of using the Java notation, Java core, Java or Java things. Let me create one class. Class name will be, you can provide the Java config, or you can use the any kind of terms. So when we start any project, then we'll use proper naming convention. But for now, I am using something like this. So which thing you want to use? Employee service. So employee service, and I want to return bean new employee service. Okay, so this is the bean which we have created now, and I need to put the bean annotation, right? Now,
yes,
we have put the bean annotations, and things will be executed. Now, if you look at the employee controller, still it is showing the error.
Okay.
So now you need to tell the system to use this configuration. I am telling Spring Boot system to use, please consider this is my configurations and as a bean. Okay. So for that, you need to put one configuration annotation to use this stuff. So when the system will going to be internally inject, this is the configuration annotation, and it will use the, and it will create the bean accordingly. It will look up for the configuration annotation, service annotation, component, and all these kind of annotations. And also from that basis, it will going to be create the bean as well. Now, if you look at error, it's removed.
Yeah.
Got it. And if you will run this one, and you will get to know things will be working as per the expected. So let me explain this one, and this is your application. It is running fine, right? Hello.
Yeah.
You got it now?
Yes, yes.
Okay, so I will take only 5 to 10 minutes more so that to explain the another things. Okay, is it fine for you? Because yes, we have already exceeded time, so but yeah, no problem. So but we need to finish actually. Otherwise, if you left the things, then we'll not, things will be covered, right? For at least today's session demo, we need to finish it. Okay, the next one is the application context. Your requirement is to get the bean. Now, how you will get the bean? So when you run, this is your Spring, this is the main method, it will return the application context. It will return the application context. Okay, so this is the application context, and you can get the bean whatever you want. So this is your container. Your requirement is to, I want to fetch any bean from any container, from this container. So you can get the bean from this container. Okay, and if you look at the bean factory, like let me explain the bean factory. I think this bean factory, XML bean factory, that is the deprecated XML bean factory. Here you can see deprecated, right? This is the cross.
Yeah.
This is the, here you can see this is a deprecated. So that's why we will not use this one. So we'll use the application context, but you should know what is that one or what is the purpose. So in the application context, you will have a get bean method or whatever you can say, get bean factory, or all these methods will be there. So I want to get the bean, right? So I can the get bean of any as per the requirement, like types, get beans of get bean factory on the basis of name, on the basis of class. Lots of overloaded method, right? Lots of overloaded method will be there. So from the overloaded method, you can pick it as per your requirement. So this is the thing. So for the tomorrow session, what we will going to do is we'll explain the Spring Boot annotation first. Okay. First, we'll start the Spring Boot annotations. And second thing is to explain the different kind of file system, different kind of XML, whatever we will have the things, like whatever the things will be the part of, you know, you can see my orange screen, class path, web XML and file system or something like this.
Okay,
till now you have any doubt so that we can discuss that part? Otherwise we'll discuss tomorrow whatever the part is left.
Okay, fine.
So any feedback for me so that you want to get the session in that way or something like this, so that I'll use that stuff, or so that, you know, will not face any problem. My intention is to, you know, to have, you will have, you should have all knowledge, and you know, you should understand the concept whatever we have discussed, because in the future we will use the same term again and again.
Yes, I understood everything. And are you going to give me the examples today for today's session also?
Yeah, you can. What I will do after, you know, 1 hour, whatever that we have discussed, what I will do is, you know, I will provide the these things into the Git repository, and you can clone from there. I will put over there.
Okay, fine. So
for this one, you can pick. Let me pick it as part of, you know, the chatting. Where is the chat window? Yes, this is the chatting, and later you can get these things in as part of, you know, the Git repository. I'll share this repository with you, or the email, or the WhatsApp as well.
Okay.
Okay. Then thank you. Other things we can discuss over the WhatsApp. Okay.
Okay. Fine.
Okay. Thank you so much. Thank you so much for your time.
Okay, man.